shape coming, and I hope everybody can see, okay, sort of okay. You guys in the back, can you see? Yeah? Okay, great. I'm Sarah Howard. I'm curator of public art and social practice here at the university, and we are delighted to have three panelists here this evening to talk about Pledges of Allegiance, our public art project, as well as Unity, Divisions, and Spaces for Intersection. So, first I want to thank the staff here at the University Contemporary Art Museum for all their efforts in putting this event together. Alyssa Cordero, who is our events coordinator, Leslie Alsasser, who is our education curator, Dave Waterman, head of security, and his team, as well as Madeline Baker, our deputy director, Noelle Smith, Tony Palms, and the preparatory team for organizing everything, and all of our marketing and communications staff as well. So we appreciate all their efforts to put this on. I want to start by introducing our esteemed panelists. I'll start to the far left. Dr. Gerling Graywall is Associate Professor in English at the University of South Florida, Tampa. She has also taught in the USF Department of Women's Studies and served as the founding director of the Center for India Studies. Trained in gender and postcolonial literary studies, she has published numerous articles on contemporary women writers. She is a recipient of a Toni Morrison Society Book Award for her monograph on Toni Morrison. She has two university-wide teaching awards and a contemplative practice fellowship for pedagogy from the American Council of Learned Societies. Her current teaching and research areas are literature and the environment, religious and philosophical themes in literature, holistic paradigms, and contemplative pedagogy. Thank you for being here. And to her right is Dr. Sean Bingham. Dr. Sean Bingham serves as the Assistant Dean of the Academic Affairs in the USF Honors College and is an Associate Professor in the Department of Sociology. Sean's research areas and teaching interests overlap through the concept of culture. He has co-authored a book on humor as a form of social action and likewise teaches a course on the social functions of humor in everyday life, which includes such settings as medicine, education, workplaces, and even advertising. He is particularly interested in ways in which humor can illuminate incongruities in everyday life, especially through irony and satire. Sean has published other books on the topics of Henry David Thoreau, political art, and the Bohemian South. He is currently working on a book about the tiny housing movement, which will include an interdisciplinary exploration of the politics, economics, and ethics of tiny housing. He leads student trips to North Carolina several times a year and lived for 5 years with his family in Beta Hall and Juniper Poplar Hall. And to my left is Noelle Mason. Noelle Mason is a multidisciplinary artist whose work is about the subtle subductiveness of power facilitated by systems of visual and institutional control. Noelle is shown nationally and internationally in a variety of non-traditional spaces, galleries, and institutions, including the National Museum of Mexican Art, Orlando Museum, and the Museum of Fine Arts, St. Petersburg. She's currently in the Skyway exhibition that's over at USF St. Pete, and at the Tampa Museum of Art. Her work's only at USF St. Pete, but the show expands from the Ringling Museum and the the Tampa Museum of Art. So if you haven't had a chance to see that, I believe the show comes down at St. Pete MFA on October 1st. It closes by then, so if you haven't had a chance, I would highly recommend going to check that out. She's the recipient of a Joan Mitchell Foundation Artist Grant, Jerome Fellowship, Santo Foundation Individual Artist Grant, and the Florida Prize for Contemporary Art and Southern Prize. In 2004, Noelle was a resident at Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture. She holds a BA in both Theater and Fine Arts from the University of California, Irvine, and received her MFA from the School of Art Institute of Chicago. Noelle currently holds the position of Associate Professor of Art at the University of South Florida. Okay, so what I thought we'd do this evening is I hope everyone had a chance to see the flag that was flying outside the museum because we're going to kind of frame our conversation around that. this evening. If you haven't had the chance, you can run out there right now and look at it. So I'm going to introduce the Pledges of Allegiance Project and delve a little bit into Robert Longo's practice, and then pose some questions to our panelists, and then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. So Pledges of Allegiance was launched by New York-based public art nonprofit Creative Time on Flag Day, June 14th. And for those of you that aren't familiar with Creative Time, it's an innovative public art agency based in New York. They do projects around the nation. And some of you, maybe if you aren't familiar, one of their most iconic projects was after 9/11, when they launched the Tribute to Light, which was the two beams of light that were kind of representing the absence of the World Trade Towers after 9/11. So for some of you, that might be a good reference point for you. So Pledges of Allegiance is a nationwide year-long public art project featuring a serialized commission of 16 flags created by acclaimed artists. Pledges of Allegiance, or conceived in response to the current political climate, Pledges of Allegiance aims to build community among cultural institutions. With an emphasis on the plurality of pledges in the title of the project, each artist-designed flag points to an issue the artist is passionate about, a cause they believe is worth fighting for, and speaks to how we might move forward collectively. USF CAM signed on as the first national participant for the year-long campaign and unique public art initiative. So here's all the flags that will be raised over the course of the year. And for some reason in this video, they did not include Yoko Ono's flag, but that's okay because today is International Peace Day. And so we can kind of honor this flag, which will be mounted later. It'll be mounted later this year in November. So each month we will mount a different artist-designed flag in coordination and solidarity with Creative Time and other participating cultural institutions. So as this is International Peace Day today, the UN General Assembly has declared this day devoted to strengthening the ideals of peace both within and among all nations and peoples. And the theme for 2017 is Together for Peace, Respect, Safety, and Dignity for All, which sort of fits with what we need these days. So this is an image from Creative Time's site that shows the 10 cultural institutions across the nation that are participating as a site raised in the Pledges of Allegiance. So there are 10 institutions flying the same flag that we're flying. We mount them, we raise them all on the same day at the same time, and there's a schedule that Creative Time has given us to follow. This is an image of Tanya Bruguera's flag on the Contemporary Art Museum. So the presence of the Pledges of Allegiance project at the museum situates it as both a space for debate and dialogue to address critical global, social, and political concerns in a creative and accessible way, as well as a site of resistance. And these are the first two flags going up on the Creative Time headquarters. Each flag embodies art's ability to channel political passion, providing a symbol of allegiance around which to unite. So Tanya Bruguera's flag, the one on the right, it says dignity has no nationality, and the image actually has all the countries on of all the continents kind of pushed together into one sort of body. And then the flag on the left is Marilyn Minter's resist flag. It was the first flag that was mounted. This was the third flag in the series. So two flags already displayed in the series, Bruguera's Dignity Has No Nationality and Nari Ward's Breathing Flag, both address social concerns of immigration, racial oppression, and injustice during pivotal moments during the summer as immigration policies introduced by the current administration and the tragic events that occurred during the Unite the Right white supremacist rally at Charlottesville, Virginia. So Creative Time is also extending this project through social media channels and is encouraging people to post images on their social media using the hashtag Pledges of Allegiance and tagging Creative Time, as well as the other social media handles for each of the artists if they have them. We are also mounting a herd funder campaign, which is kind of like a Kickstarter version of fundraising to help us sponsor this project, because we were offered the opportunity to participate in this project, and we had a very short time frame to participate. It was like a 2-week turnaround. The team really scrambled to get approval to mount a flagpole on the building and get off, go through the proper university channels. So we were able to do that, but we didn't have it included in our budget. So on October 1st, we're launching our Herd Funder campaign, and there's giving levels from $10 up to $500, I believe. So we're hoping that you guys can help us spread the word about that campaign. So the current flag that we have raised is Robert Longo's Pledges of Allegiance flag, which is based on the artist's 2016 large-scale charcoal drawing exhibited in Longo's The Destroyer Cycle exhibition at Metro Pictures in New York City. So The Destroyer Cycle is the title that Longo has given to all the work that he will create during the time of the current administration is in office. This is the drawing, and it's titled Untitled, November 8th, 2016, and it was completed the day of the recent presidential election. The two-panel drawing of the American flag is separated by 5 inches between the left panel and the right panel, and the latter measures slightly larger than the former, and it's reflecting the current symptomatic divide in the United States. Throughout history, artists have made artwork documenting, reflecting, and responding to social, cultural, and political events of the world. And Longo's monumental drawings are sourced from the visual imagery produced in mass media, and they capture and reframe over 3 decades of cultural events. Longo was born in 1953 in Brooklyn, and he grew up on Long Island and came of age during the political uprisings of the late 60s and the Kent State University massacre in 1970, and was deeply impacted and influenced by the symbolic power of mass media, newspapers, movies, television, magazines, and comic books. While studying at State University College in Buffalo in the early 70s, Longo co-founded exhibition space Hall Walls and featured shows and talks with the New York artists he admired, Vito Acconci, John Baldessari, Linda Bengalis, Robert Irwin, Joan Jonas, Bruce Nauman, and Richard Serra. During this time, he established an informal network that became seminal to his artistic development. And after moving to New York in 1977 with his then-girlfriend, Cindy Sherman, Longo was one of 5 artists included in Douglas Primm's exhibition at Artist Space titled Pictures. Formerly labeled as the Pictures Generation, this group of artists were moving away from minimalism and conceptualism and embracing the use of images appropriated from mass media to criticize the visual saturation of consumer culture and the advertising industry. Translated through Longo's lens of political disillusionment, the large-scale, labor-intensive graphite and coal, charcoal drawings transforms and elevates those mass media images, creating dark cinematic portraits of power, violence, and disaster present in our American culture. He continues to mine images to create these visualizations of aggression portraying our culture. This was an ad he created in response to Charlottesville that, for T Magazine. He was included with 5 other artists that were asked to make images in response to those events. Longo's Black Flag series of distressed and blackened flags continue to reflect on themes of power, patriotism, and identity, consistent throughout his depictions of the American symbols of power, including many iterations of the flag, the U.S. Capitol, and the Constitution, focusing on depictions of the First Amendment. And just last month, he installed this new public artwork in New York City depicting the American flag and the First Amendment of the Constitution across these pedestrian bridges at Hunter College. While able to be seen from the street, these images actually envelop the diverse student body in these symbols and representations of free speech and expression as they traverse these walkways. So, using the Longo flag as a metaphor for the current state of the union and probing that sort of black strip between the right and the left as a space for intersection and common ground, I'm going to delve into talking about some of the issues of allegiance. And as we delve into this discussion, I want everyone to feel that their voice is welcome and valued. This is an open forum where everyone's opinions and perspectives and beliefs are respected. So initiated thousands of years ago for military purposes on land and then on sea, flags were used as identifying signals for communication. Over the centuries, flags have evolved to represent royal houses, territories, and boundaries, levels of government, businesses, military ranks and units, sports teams, political parties, and many other identities. Flags have evolved to become symbols to show heritage, solidity, unity around these specific identities. So at this point, I wanted to open a few questions to our panelists. First, I would like to address how flag functions as a visual symbol and becomes invested with value and power and crafts allegiance, and talk about where this power comes from. So, Amy, do you want to start? Use that, it just helps for the video consistency because we'll document this on the web.
So a flag is a vital component of any nation's self-imagining. Historian Benedict Anderson said, nations are the result of an act of imagination, imagined communities. And Eric Hobsbawm, another historian, speaks of invented traditions. So I want to flag invention and imagination as being part of the construction of a nation. And art also functions the same way, imagining, constructing, deconstructing. So we have two sets, I think, given this is another set, this is not the dominant official version of construction of the nation, this is an alternative one. But so your question was, what accounts for the value can you repeat that?
Yeah. Well, how flag functions becomes invested with value and power. Where does that power come from?
Yeah, I think we are enlisted in that identification process as children and then later as adults. You know, all the pomp and glory of those rituals, the solemnity, the grandeur. I want to say they evoke something in us that wants to relate to something wider, bigger, than the solitary self, right? So we identify beyond the family, the clan, the tribe, and then there's the nation. So this is the positive aspect of nation building. And I think the production of sentiment, affect, and the devotion that the flag entails is all part of that identification that very early on we are sort of inducted into and we participate in. So, stop there.
Do you guys have anything to add to that?
Go ahead.
Sure.
Should be on.
Am I on?
You're on.
First of all, who set up the tables with the black?
We always use black here at the museum.
I was very pleased about that because I got up in the dark today to take my kids to school. And I put on white socks with my khaki pants, and I was like, oh god, these people are going to think I'm a total geek because I have white socks. So, thank you for adding my lens.
You just gave yourself away.
Sorry. Good point. So just a couple of things. First of all, I don't teach on flags, and so I'm a cultural sociologist, but one of the things I was thinking in terms of this, and I'm going to connect a little bit to the courses that I cover, but first of all, the conspicuousness of flags, I think, is incredibly important. I mean, there's people who sort of hide any symbols inside and keep them to themselves. We're not really talking about groups, right? I mean, I think the public display of flags is important because that creates shared meaning, whether it's teaching, socializing kids. There's a public aspect of flag waving that's incredibly important. You have to get your message out to others to demonstrate some type of meaning about the flag. and I was going to talk about our meeting alone, but she did it in a much more articulate way than I would. Flags certainly are about belonging, something more than yourself. But what really came to mind, I teach a class on consumer culture, and I'm not a postmodernist, but I take sort of a postmodern view of flags, and I think that in many ways, this is not a perfect analogy, but flags function in the way brands do, branding images. And brands really are about meaning and purpose, and in some sense belonging to a group of people. If you buy a certain brand, you feel like you're part of a select group, and you judge people who wear another different brand, right? I think that's what we all do. Even though we would like to claim in a progressive sense that we don't, all of us look at other people and see the brands that they wear. And that's in a similar way, flags function that way. There's a sense of belonging, who's in the in group, who's in the out group. So I think that brands can be somewhat illustrative here. I talk a lot in my courses about emotional branding, and I think you touched on this affect that flags certainly tap into emotions. I will admit that as a child, back when I was 3 or 4, thinking back to when I first sort of became conscious of the flag as part of national identity, I really only associated the flag with the Olympics, because that's when it was really waved in front of my face, and I actually for a couple of years thought that like the flag was only part of the Olympics. I don't know why. Maybe that says something about my parents or where I went to school. But it wasn't until later that I saw the flag as a national symbol of identity. So I would say to the group, you know, as we're moving through this discussion, I don't know, I found brands and brand loyalty and brand allegiance really an interesting window into thinking about flags. Because as I was looking at some of these, I mean, they could actually be brand images for products in some way, if you look at some of them. So that's all for now.
I have a couple of things to add, and then I think the first one kind of piggybacks on that, and that's you know, flags gain this kind of power through design, right? We think about a country like Afghanistan has changed their flag something like 17 times in the last 20 some odd years, right? You know, thinking about the battle flag of the Confederacy, right? Why is it that flag, that particular flag, that's become known as the Southern flag? Because it was just one of, you know, any number of battle flags that were used. It wasn't considered the flag of the South at that time. And I think a lot of that has to do with symmetry. It has to do with, you know, familiarity, right? It borrows a little bit from the Union Jack, as we did, right, both with color and, but I think it's actually kind of a better flag than the United States flag, design-wise, right? It's sort of like, using diagonals, triangles, and symmetry, bilateral symmetry, we're very attractive to those things. And the other thing that I would add is performance, that the flag is a performance. It's not an object in the same way that other objects are. And some of that performance has to do with the law, right? So making things illegal to do to the flag, ritual, how the flag is not allowed to, say, touch the ground. If it does touch the ground, it has to be burned in a specific way. If you burn the flag publicly, you can be arrested for it, right, in certain scenarios or at certain times in this country. And so so the performance of a flag is equally, the fact that it usually is above you, right? And sometimes very high above you. It's usually larger than you. It commands respect because of how big it is and how tall it is and how violently it can whip in the wind, right? So it's that's maybe what I would add to what has already been said.
And that sort of leads into my next question about how these symbols are created and maintained and sustained through our culture, something like the Confederate flag that isn't, you know, really a representative of anything but a sort of Southern aspect of our
as a sociologist, I'm interested in groups of people. So I would say several ways, and I made a few notes on this, official events, gatherings, you know, many of us learn about the flag in school. There is a state law here, which I'm sure many of you are aware of, that a flag must be in every public institution's classroom. Any classroom that we have here is supposed to have a flag in it. So there are a number of institutions of authority that promote the flag. But in my own life, even milestones that happened at various, whether it's somebody being buried or other sports games, I mean, there's a lot of debate right now about Colin Kaepernick and standing and not. So there are a number of different official events that take place that really play an important role as an agent of socialization. Traditions, I could go into a lot of detail about that. I'm more interested in the use of exclusion and fear in terms of shaping or changing our views of the flag. I think a large portion of some of what's played a role in the issue with the Confederate flag, and even the American flag, is people who don't feel that they belong currently or feel like something is being lost cling to this symbol as something very sacred. If there's anybody in the room that's read Durkheim's Sacred and Profane, as you mentioned very well, the flag is to many people a very sacred thing. And so in times when people feel challenged or that they're losing something, they really cling to the flag. I'm also, in a similar fashion, interested in flat symbols, any symbol that gets reappropriated or the meaning of it gets changed. I mean, the swastika is a good example of something that's centuries old to a number of different groups. But all of a sudden, for most of us, what we associate with it is Germany, right? Even though that was not the original intent. I can tell you, I will never look at a tiki torch the same. Whereas, you know, as a college student in St. Augustine, Florida, we would go buy them and stick them on the beach. I don't think I'd be doing that anymore. And that's because I really just have a sour taste in my mouth about tiki torches. So there are a number of ways in which flags and symbols can shift. In my own case, I had sort of an apathetic view of the flag, and then, you know, I guess living in D.C. and working two blocks from the White House on September 11th, you know, I had some sort of loose emotional connection to it, and now zero. So I think time periods can change people's attachment. I think challenges to people's identity can change it. And groups, you know, like the Nazis, can reappropriate it in a really intriguing way, sadly.
This is about how it means,
how the is created, maintained, and sustained.
So I'm actually going to focus on the created part. Who here, is anyone here starting a country? Did anybody start a country in this? Where's Libby? Saw her. You didn't start a country? You must not have been in that class, sorry.
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay.
You all need to run out and start your own.
So I have a class in which I have all my students start their countries, and so one of the first things that they have to do after sort of figuring out what their country is make a flag. And so I've been around a lot of, especially recently since we're in the middle of that project, creation of different types of flags, right? And you know, flags are designed by all different people. They might be designed by individuals, but oftentimes they are designed by committee, which is, I think, how we get flags like the state of Florida's flag, which is in sort of penultimate example of a terrible flag. any of you know what I'm talking about. But I do think that I would go back to saying there's something about the iconic nature of a well-designed flag. Personally, I'm a little jealous of like the Union Jack. It's a flag that I wish I was represented by. And I know plenty of Brits have really sort of sentimental feelings about that flag, I think, that go beyond, in some ways, its sort of explicit meaning, right, and are more just about like the way it looks.
Kind of taps under a lot of public art that is created by committee, right?
Yeah.
Can I just add a word?
Yeah, please.
So I think to do the work, the flag as a pledge of allegiance, these and other symbols like this need to be maintained and sustained through culture. In fact, they perform a work, right, that of allegiance and identification, and every state performs, it's performative, and you mentioned that earlier, but I think that's really the crux of it, that just as we know identity is performative, it's the same thing as allegiance at a vaster collective level as a nation, and every state, and this is useful from a transnational perspective, this is not just the United States, you know, every nation has this. This is what makes a nation work. And the fact is that the nation is a conflictual terrain, and there are debates and contestations of what makes a nation. This is an example of it, the whole variety of it. And for the nation to cohere, you have to reiterate that pledge, right? So we know the military does it, and I think soldiers, if you say, I've had a soldier, ex-soldier in my class, and I was teaching Doris Lessing's sort of iconoclastic view of the nation. You know, she was a progressive South African writer who was critiquing it. And so the student actually thought I was dismissing all patriotism in the discussion and took umbrage because she was from the military. And as I said, yes, you know, we take these things seriously in the military. Yeah, that's part of who you are as a soldier. The flag is sacred. So I think along with stories and poems, you know, flags also stitch this collective fabric of who we are as a people. And I think it's ubiquitous, these sorts of reinforcing identity. There's so many ways that I was saying, oh my God, where do I start and where do I stop? But just that.
I think that's just on something that is interesting about a flag and sometimes dangerous about a flag, right? Is that we create the flag as a symbol to serve individuals. But then at a certain point, the flag becomes the thing that individuals serve. And I think when a nation forgets that the flag is there to serve the people in the nation and not the other way around, we start on some very dangerous territory where we end up using people as pawns in sort of games of politics.
That's really good. So, thinking about that, how can flags embody the hopes and the dreams and the aspirations of the public? You know, the flag is often, you know, after something like a disaster, I know we all kind of saw that happen, I think it was, there's so many disasters going on, it's hard to keep straight, but I think it was in Houston where somebody rescued the flag, and it's like the flag being sort of remounted and being put upright after it's been, you know, blown down or put down by some sort of disaster. It's the first thing to kind of go up and kind of capture the public's strength again and sort of show that sort of solidarity.
So what was the question, Derek? Is that
aspirations.
How does it embody that?
Well, I think the flags are a language, right? And we have to, you know, in order for it to even even begin to do any of these things, it has to be a legible language. And it really only embodies these things if you feel included in the language of the flag, right? So in terms of our flag, right, one of the ways in which we have done that is by including a star for every state. And very much the American citizens who are represented by that flag, who are one of those 50 stars, have a very different position in the nation than the American citizens who are not represented by those stars. So thinking right now of Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands, who are suffering tremendously at the hand of two major hurricanes, when the news came out and said, were evacuating American citizens, who they meant were tourists, ignoring the fact that everyone who lives there are also American citizens, but are not represented in that flag. So I think through the symbolism of the flag and its ability or inability to include or make people feel included is one of the ways in which it can embody those hopes and dreams.
Follow up on that with the rainbow flag by Gilbert Baker is a great example of that, representing the hopes, dreams, aspirations, right? And started in 1978 with the Gay Parade, and it kept being modified through the years as a symbol of LGBTQ solidarity and flown on various commemorations from Stonewall to finally in 2015 to the White House, where all the colors of the rainbow, you know, the White House were reflected on the White House, pretty dramatic. And yet, this rainbow proved to be inadequate to represent the minority black community in Philadelphia, right? Who felt that the rainbow flag, which was international in scope, did not represent them. And so the flag became even more colorful, and you had a brown and a black stripe added to it. So, you know, that's part of this whole dialogue that happens within a democracy, within a nation, that it's contentious and, sort of dialectic. You propose, you know, thesis, antithesis, and a synthesis. And I guess I'm personally not too disturbed by that, because it's just how the way this political process shapes itself.
I think too, like the fact that our flag is, there's an element of its evolution visually, right, is a nice sort of metaphor for the evolution of the Constitution or the ability of the Constitution to be amended, right? The flag can also be amended.
Yes.
Neutral to negative view of the American flag, but certainly my generation, born in the late 1970s, and then forward, I think have a very different connection to the flag than our parents. I have sort of a neutral to apathetic view of the flag. So I think people from my generation, people from my generation and down are looking to different types of flags. Ones that you mentioned, or even sports teams. I mean, I'm always intrigued by sports team fans as tribes who get in fist fights with other sports team fans, and it's because they're wearing different flags or colors. This seems to be really fascinating to me. People will spend a lot of money on these colors and flags. I know we spend, I'm pretty sure, much more money on if we call a team jersey a flag, which it is a sort of flag, then those generation of people do on American flags. There's way more money spent on those types of flags. So I think I would put forth that for for some groups of people, maybe not the majority, maybe not all, but for a significant portion, the American flag doesn't hold aspirations, hopes, and dreams, and so other flags do for them. Sports teams are certainly a big one. I mean, I saw something over the weekend of two groups fighting tribally, really, because their teams were on the field fighting, and probably none of them ever played sports in their lives in the crowd, but there they were beating it out. And, you know, it really brought to image this sort of medieval group of guys with two different flags fighting over nothing. It was kind of silly. But it was, and I also think of the sports teams, you know, pick your sport, but at the beginning of the year, when that flag is raised, there were hopes, dreams, and aspirations that your team will win the Super Bowl or whatever your sport is. I think people of my generation are turning to different flags, certainly depending on where you live and your politics, but I find that there's a significant portion of people of my age range that they don't own a flag, they don't fly it on their house. You know, maybe they'll pledge allegiance at a baseball game or something like that, but they have a very different connection to flags than, let's say, my dad's generation, he was born in 1936. The flag is very much a sacred thing for him. For me, it's a much more neutral object.
Can I just add to that from a transnational perspective? Maybe some of you have heard of Arundhati Roy, the novelist from India, who's also an activist. Her description of a flag is just sacrilegious, to say the least, but it makes for an interesting comment. Flags, I quote, "Flags are bits of colored cloth that governments use first to shrink wrap people's minds and then as ceremonial shrouds to bury the dead." So that's another thing where I talk about being neutral. I guess I'm sitting on the far left, aren't I?
Well, they're far right.
Right. It's all relative.
One of the striking things, I've been paying a lot of attention to flags since we started this project, but even before we started this project, one of the things I found striking was that the president has his own flag, which just seems really weird to me. And I noticed during Gasparilla's past year that there were a lot of those flags flying around on people's boats and different things, which I just thought was really interesting as kind of cultural comment. Why somebody that's, you know, been elected as president would need their own flag. Obviously, he has it for his hotel, so maybe they already had it. So before we open it up to the audience, I want to ask one more question. During times of civil unrest, art and humor often rise up as exceptional forms of expression of the time. How can art and humor challenge or transform allegiances?
Humor is right up his alley.
Also taught a course on comedy, so I'm going to defer her first.
All right, I'll start. Okay. I actually think that art and humor do very similar things. I think the word aesthetics, right, it comes from the root word of to feel, right? And so anesthetics, which you're all familiar with, right, is taking away sensation. But aesthetics, and what we do as aestheticians, right, is, I think, central to that is an experience of, or making a person or an audience feel something, right? And comedy does it as well. It's they're quite similar. In fact, I think they're both disciplines where nothing is sacred, right? Going too far is often how far you have to go. Crossing a line is how we define the line, right? And they're the two places where we're really kind of culturally allowed to do that. So in terms of transforming allegiances, I mean, I think that there's the ability to get at somebody's gut without going through their head initially, allows you to, I believe, allows someone to enter a dialogue, enter a conversation that they normally wouldn't maybe participate in, or maybe they think they already know the answer to. And so if you can get somebody to laugh at something, right, and maybe that something is themselves, then you can start to have a conversation that disarms some of those, or that is disarming, right? That is not just a back and forth waiting for, it's a real conversation. It's not just talking at each other, right? Waiting for the other person to stop talking so you can say whatever it is that you have to say, because there are no words, right, with art. Not always, there's obviously words, but but oftentimes, right, art is like without language. So it allows you to get something across that barrier of talking at each other and start from a more guttural, emotional level.
Much better than I was said. I wrote a whole book to explain this to myself, so I will not go into that level of detail, but I could have just come and listened to what she said, because that was pretty good. I'm really interested in forms of humor where the aesthetic itself is the form of analysis, so if you're interested in irony or incongruity humor, humor that is funny because it has a cognitive shift at the end, that form of humor deconstructs, it disorders, it reorders, it reveals, it unveils things, particularly about the way power works. So, and you know, to piggyback on some of your great comments, that form of humor grabs people, it's interesting, it's entertaining. I just finished a book last year on stand-up comedians with disabilities and their use of the stand-up stage to engage people in discussions about disability. Very few people would pay money to go sit and listen to somebody complain about the way society treats them, whether it's about race or gender, etc. But the comedy stage is the one place where people will pay money and then a two-drink minimum to sit down and listen to somebody talk about race, politics, sex, fill in the blank, right? It's really the only venue I know of where someone will fork over a lot of money to do that. So it really is this fascinating place to have discussions that in any other venue, like at the Thanksgiving table, you're not supposed to talk about, you know, politics and religion, right? On the comedy stage, you can, and as many of these comedians that we interviewed would tell you, they would soften people up and then come with really searing critical jokes, and people leave very moved by that. We had a number of folks who are comedians who also do disability awareness training. They could tell you, I could spend a whole week in a formal training session like this on a panel, or I could spend 20 minutes of comedy and I could reach them in 20 minutes versus a whole week. So it really is this vessel for talking about socially important issues. The last thing I want to say is thinking about flags and how they're sacred, I was also coming to this thinking about comedy, political correctness, and the idea that both art and humor, nothing is sacred, is incredibly relevant to the flags, because in comedy, you know, political correctness is pushed aside many times, right? And it's done for an important reason in many cases, not all. So I think there's an analogy there to flags, right? Flags are seen as sacred, and words are seen as sacred. There are certain words that should not be used, right? And there are many words that are being reappropriated by certain comedians. So I find it, I actually have taught, I got into this whole issue of comedy with teaching students, social theorists, and I couldn't get them to read a damn thing about the social theorists. But if I would, the class before, give them a teaser, like show them George Carlin, and then say, okay, now you're gonna watch George Carlin's Golf Courses for the Homeless. If you haven't seen that, check it out online. And now you're gonna read Karl Marx. And just that little teaser, like these kids would actually read chapters of Emile Durkheim, who's not exciting. It's probably why no one in the room has heard of him. It's very dry. But this little teaser, it would get them engaged. Okay, I can do this, and then they would actually read. So it really is a great vessel for talking about taboo issues, for getting people. I mean, many of these comedians, you have people from really diverse political backgrounds in the same room. I mean, think, for those of you who know Dave Chappelle, think about the diverse group of kids, college kids, who watched that show when it was out. And one of the reasons he quit was because the really conservative fraternity kids who were watching him didn't get the jokes. They thought it was actually reinforcing some of their ideas. But he had an incredibly diverse audience watching the show, and that speaks to the ability of comedy to be an interesting vessel in a way I think many flags aren't. Some of the meaning of flags are very limited, whereas comedy can reach, it's a great form of public sociology. In the same way that cartoons in the 1800s, you know, political cartoons were reaching people who couldn't read, right? But they were able to engage in political issues because they could make sense of the visual imagery. Comedy reaches a really broad audience that way.
So I want to say outrage can be a form of patriotism too, right? And satire and laughter. And patriotism does not always have to be chauvinistic. That our comedians are out there holding the democratic fort, so to speak, to keep alive alternative points of view. So yay to the comedians. But I also want to talk about the darker aspect, the suffering aspect, if you will. And I'd like to quote from Parker Palmer, who has a wonderful book called Healing the Heart of Democracy. And in it he says, and I just, if you allow me to quote, I just quote from him. This is Parker Palmer. We suffer from a widespread loss of jobs, homes, savings, citizen confidence in our economic and political system. We suffer from a fragmentation of community that leaves us isolated from one another. What shall we do with our suffering? Sometimes suffering rises into anger that leads to murder or war, or to despair that leads to quick or slow self-destruction. And then I love what he says here. Violence is what we get when we do not know what else to do with our suffering. And I want to say that art offers us an alternative, is a way to enter suffering, our own and other people's, so that we don't have to act it out in other ways that are so destructive and violent. And art is a wonderful way to affirm, indeed, as this flyer says here, and this flag, that dignity has no nationality, suffering has no borders, and neither does global finance or climate change, we know that, and thankfully neither does our humanity. And our humanity need not be checked at the borders. And I think that's what art does. I've been a student of literature all my life, and really that was a way of being truly a citizen of the world. It's become a fashionable slogan now, part of, I guess it's part consumerist and part idealism. You know, we say we all want to be global citizens, yay. But truly literature or art, any kind of art that is heartfelt, and you mentioned viscera, you know, the gut. I said gut, and I translated viscera or visceral. And art has that visceral response that elicits this deeper contemplation, you know, where otherwise we might be defended and not receive those messages that are coming from very thoughtful places from writers and artists. So that's the power of literature in transforming suffering.
Okay, I think that's a great point to open up to the audience for questions. I've got a few hands up out there.
I mean, I think it's hard, I mean, it's hard to the chicken and the egg conversation, right? But there are certain sort of punctuated moments. You know, there is a, with every flag, a point in which it is created. It's in its current form. Our flag, in its current form, was created by a 17-year-old high school student in a class contest in which he got, or a class assignment, which he got an B-. So his teacher didn't think very highly of our current flag, apparently. But so there is a point of creation. I mean, I think looking at, say, the battle flag of the Confederacy, you have a situation in which that flag during the Jim Crow era became a way in which white people could band together as particularly white Southerners, and it being used and flown by the KKK specifically, and then the continuation of violent groups of white nationalists flying that flag has had dramatic effects on the way in which we view that flag today, right? So it was a decisive moment in which people picked up that flag, started using it as symbolic for the South, but obviously not to represent all of the people in the South, right? It was meant to represent only specific people in the South. And so, you know, that is a case in which it did not evolve slowly. It was an intentional evolution of the meaning of that flag. I mean, William Pobel did a kind of amazing piece called Trinket that is a huge American flag and with 51 stars. And it blows with these, it exists inside and blows with these huge fans and unravels over time. And he talked about the flag as being both a point of agreement and a point of contention, and I think that that's a really interesting aspect of the flag, is that it holds both of these things in its in sort of suspension, right, in the same object. I don't know if that answered your question, but
some of it.
In times where any unity is helpful or needed. I mean, I think about my dad in particular and his brothers. My dad grew up as one of 10 kids in West Virginia. Five of his brothers were in World War II, so it was sort of like Saving Private Ryan. And so they have a very close connection to the flag. I did not grow up in a time of war. Just to sort of illustrate what you're asking, I mean, I think I felt some loose connection to the flag living in D.C. and watching the nastiness of September 11th that happened. So I think it's I would agree with that. If I don't know where that's where you're coming from, but certainly I think people rally around a flag in times of conflict or in times of crisis, or even personally when people. I mean, I have a lot of friends who have moved to the U.S. from other countries, and they love this country. But being here alone by themselves, they miss their home country. And so they have a flag in their house of their home country, or they have a flag hanging in their car. This makes some Americans incredibly angry. But But it's a time of personal conflict for these people because they're away from their homeland. Even though they're happy to be here, they miss their family, they miss food, they miss all kinds of cultural things. So I do think the flag is an emotional way to make some connection in time of conflict. And you're, and you know, it's a great point that you made about sports teams. I mean, it's absolutely conflict. I mean, I have, you can see people walk around campus with shirts that say, I bleed green and gold, I bleed, you know, orange and blue, I bleed garnet and gold. I mean, these are real tribal flags for these people. This is serious stuff. It's big money, but it's also emotional stuff. So yes, the answer is yes.
I have a question on that show. Is it possible to love more than one country, or does it have to be monogamous? You can only love one country.
So are people nationalistic whores? Is that what you're asking? No, I think it's possible. And I even look at, I guess sort of the flip side of that question is, the one time when I actually get pretty intrigued and excited about flags and sort of figure out which flags do I know, I don't watch a lot of the Olympics, but I will watch the opening session. And, you know, the cultural part of the flags and identifying the country and the flags sort of being melded into the outfits that various teams wear, that's pretty interesting to me. But absolutely, I mean, I have friends that have studied abroad in a particular country and they come back with that country's flag and they really, or people who've been in the Peace Corps, and they feel a really close sense of connection to that country, even though they know that they're not, you know, identified nationally with that country.
Just like speaking more than one language is an asset, loving more than one country
sure.
is also an asset, as you understand, and you have a wider affiliation rather than this, you know, this brings us to the shadow side of the nation and the flag.
Yeah.
Because even though it affirms something positive, a collectivity, it has done so while excluding. So the exclusion is built in to the very identity, right? Us, them. And you can say, well, you've got to be pragmatic. You have to have borders. So you have to have us, them. Yes, but that us, them can slide into us versus them. And that's when it's a problem, right? Xenophobia, ethnic cleansing, kinds of horrors.
Also, this is where I'm really fascinated with the aesthetic discussion of flags, because I don't know a lot about, I don't have the skill to sort of break down the aesthetics. And I mean, there's something about, I guess because my family's from the UK, but I also, I like the Union Jack, but I also recognize the really awful things that the Union Jack represented. And
yeah,
so I'm
yeah.
sort of conflicted, as I'm sure many people are. And I find that in my own family, I have a lot of family in Tennessee and West Virginia, and the ones that are most vehemently, hopefully you're not watching this video, the ones who are most vehemently wedded to the flag, there's a connection between their really tight, sacred view of the flag and their inability to admit that the U.S. has done even a few really bad things nationwide. There seems to be this blind allegiance to the flag that also melds into their lack of inability to critically engage with any global mistakes that we've made. And that's really disturbing to see amongst family members.
Well, I mean, I think that's also that sort of irony is also happens in like a state like Texas, where the state legally, you know, has retained its sort of ability to fly the Texas flag over the U.S. flag, and also, but yet it's a state in which every house has a U.S. flag on it, right? Or you know, you see more flags there than, and also the people who are maybe most likely to fly the Confederate flag, right? Also very patriotic to the U.S. flag, even though they're flying a flag which was essentially a treasonous flag, right? So it's like, the you know, we're not consistent human beings.
No.
We are hypocrisies all of the time. And maybe the allegiance to any flag makes you more likely to be allegiant to other things as well. That sort of biological drive that drives sort of hate, or patriotism is the right word, but attachment to symbols.
Yeah.
And speaking about the Olympics and tapping into that, is, I was really interested when they had the refugee flag for the refugee athletes that participated in the Olympics, which was a really important thing for them to be able to walk out as a group, even though they weren't from the same nations, but to still be belong to a flag, even though it was a, you know, a nation's flag, but it was a refugee status flag.
We have other questions?
Then, Bill.
This is kind of speaking more towards the earlier discussion about events like Charlottesville or similar with the Battle Flag of the Confederacy and things along those lines. Is there any hope that at some point in the future or in the near future, distant future, that symbols like flags that represent, we'll say, less tasteful events in our history can be understood as something more positive or can be replaced with more positive messages? Something like the Battle Flag of the Confederacy at once did hold an important meaning to someone, but that meaning was not always good, and is there a hope for it to be good in the future?
Like that specific flag transitioning meaning? I mean, I think that's what they do, basically. I mean, you know, there's always this, I mean, right now we're seeing sculptures like the, I had this professor in grad school who always said, like, when the revolution happens, sculpture is the first thing to go. You know, it's the first thing to get torn down whenever there's any revolution anywhere, right? And so, you know, we have this thing going on currently, right, where we are trying to, or there's this contention about what type of public sculptures we want to have representing us as a people. Here in Tampa, this war was fought, or is being fought. It's pretty much settled at this point, but you know, just over the last month or so. So, I mean, we're in this constant state of, look, humans are symbolic creatures. The way we can, the ability to converse with each other is symbolic action, right? Every way we attempt to understand someone else is through symbols, signs, icons, right? So these pieces of language which we put up as monuments, right, are in constant conversation with their public. And if these monuments are deemed to be offensive to a significant part of that public, if we want to remain united, we should probably rethink the monuments.
It's a process, yes.
I guess it depends on the symbol. This is a really simplistic view, but when I was 5, sadly to admit, I watched The Dukes of Hazzard. I didn't know anything about the Civil War, so like I associated the flag with The Dukes of Hazzard. And then, of course, I learned. But then there are other symbols. I have friends in other countries that have had pretty traumatic things happen. They had a particular view of the flag because of those things. They moved here. Their view of the flag has sort of at least become neutral now. So I guess it sort of depends on a particular object. I do wonder about the statues. I mean, I don't know if anybody saw the mayor of New Orleans speech about the statues, but he did a damn good job, I thought. And he's a guy that, admittedly, when I turn the TV on and you see him, that viewpoint took me off guard because stereotypically I just saw him and he looked like a high school wrestling coach that I had. And I thought, you know, he was going to say, these statues are here to stay, you know, from my cold dead hand kind of speech. And he gave this really articulate speech about if you're a young African-American girl and you're walking through the park and you see that statue, what message does that give you in terms of your hopes and dreams as a young African-American girl? So You know, it's an interesting time with the statues. I just read something about Stone Mountain in Georgia, where, if you're not familiar with that, it's not a statue per se, but it's carved almost like Mount Rushmore into the side of a mountain. And I wonder, like, you know, okay, if you got a bunch of liberal progressives who don't want you to destroy the environment, what are you going to do, like blow up the mountain? I mean, how do you get this big sculptural image out of there? It's going to become interesting to watch as a sociologist, for sure. But some of these images, I think, can morph and change. I mean, and I hate to keep going back to brands, but in the same way that brand imagery can become more positive and negative, it's not a complete, perfect analogy, but some of them, the historical meanings have been so long attached that I think it's more difficult.
Well, some of those things, I think, you know, it's the justification for keeping them and putting them in a museum, right?
Right.
They're a place,
context.
You know, we're not here to destroy history. We're here to give history context.
Right.
And some places are better for that context than others, right? And so that's, you know, if you really believe in preserving, you know, the history of, say, the Battle Flag of the Confederacy, then it should be seen in a museum.
Right, yeah. And it, you know.
Because it's out there, you know, being manipulated all over the place now, right? So, you know, Dukes of Hazzard, and, you know, and at that time, right, other countries just saw it the same way you did.
Right.
It's just an American symbol. It's not, it doesn't mean anything other than just.
Yeah, and whose history are we preserving, right? Because the same people that are standing up and arguing to keep the Confederate monuments, I can guarantee you, are not the ones asking questions about the TBX expansion into the historically African-American community, where churches will be coming down, and what happened in the 1960s of destroying that community by putting I-4 through there. I mean, it's always, you know, their particular history that they're concerned about. I don't see people arguing for those statues, arguing for the history of other historic places that belong to other people.
I think it's a narcissistic wound that needs healing. You know, just as lots, I mean, it takes time. But that's what a flag is, you know, sort of a narcissistic, you know, self-reflection. Somehow related.
Did anybody see the, speaking of symbols and monuments, here comes the sort of comedy piece of addressing something. The monuments around the U.S. where somebody has gone up and put a second place ribbon on the Confederate statues.
Does anybody have any other questions? All right, well, I want to thank you all for being here. And